Lord, we just thank you for this day. Lord, we just thank you for the cross. Lord, for the grave. But oh, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for your resurrection. Lord, that you're seated at the right hand of the Father. So, Lord, we give you honor. We give you glory. We give you praise because you're worthy. You're worthy. Look to your neighbor on your right and left and say, he is worthy. Jesus is worthy. Will you stand with us? We're going to worship this morning.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. We believe. And in this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And he's given us new life. Crucifixion. We believe that he conquered hell. We believe in his resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe.
So let our faith be more than
Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered hell. We believe in his resurrection, and that he's coming back again. We believe in God the Father. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe.
excited about what today represents. Give somebody a high five and tell them, I believe. Come on, somebody.
Amen. I believe.
I believe. I believe. Hey, awesome. We are so thrilled to have you guys here. You can sit down for just a few minutes, but don't let your seat get too warm because we're going to be jumping and shouting in just a second. Yeah, it's going to be a good day, man. I'm pumped.
Hey, we are so excited to have you here worshiping with us this morning. We believe that God is so good and so faithful, and we want to lift up his name together with you this morning. Amen?
Yes, amen. Absolutely, yes.
So if you are a first-time visitor or if we have not yet connected with you, we want to do that. And here's a way that we can. If you would get out your phone and text the word welcome to this number, 618-777-6779. It'll be up here in just a second for you as well. The number is 618-777-6779. We just want to connect with you, like I said, and be able to just check in with you. And
let's just do this. If this is your first, second, or third time here, will you just raise your hand real fast just so we can say, hey, raise your hand if the first,
welcome.
Second, or third time here. Hands everywhere.
Welcome.
Hey, let's welcome all of our first, second,
yes.
and third time visitors. That's good stuff.
So
good stuff. Hey, as you guys might know, in a church like ours, there's always a lot to do, and we count on people who just give selflessly of themselves to help get it done. With that being said, next Saturday will be our annual work day, and that's going to begin at 7:30 in the morning. So if you are able to come, give an hour, give a couple of hours of your time and of your talents to help us clean things up around here for, you know, the spring and summer as we're coming into it, we'd love for you to come join us at 7:30 in the morning next Saturday, April 27th.
Awesome. If you have not yet had the opportunity to be baptized, we want to invite you to take part in that. Our next baptism is going to be on May 5th, and today is the last day to sign up for that. So there are a couple ways you can do that. One is in our app, and the other one is out at the Connect desk. Mm-hmm. So make sure that you do that today if you're interested. There will be a class next Sunday that you will need to be a part of, and we're excited for you to be able to do this. We want to get you connected that way, so that's how you do that. Also, our next steps class, if you're not familiar with what that is, we want to share with you exactly what God is doing here at Little Chapel and how you can get involved. So even if you've come for years and you've not attended our Next Steps class, highly encourage you to do that. So our next Steps class begins on May 5th as well in room 129.
Room 129. That's right. We are coming up again on summertime, and at the end of summer, there's going to be this incredible celebration that we are calling Impact 2019. If you're excited about Impact, you already know what it is. Can you make some noise about Impact, man? It's going to be absolutely incredible. We're so excited about what God is going to do in this region, and we really just want to take a moment to let maybe some of you who have not heard yet know what's coming to Southern Illinois. This is going to be a Christian music festival with bands such as Building 429, North Point Worship, Bon Ray, and Austin French. It's going to be an all-day event, free for our community, and it's going to be held at the Saline County Fairgrounds. We have really prayed into what this event is even going to be called, and we really feel like God has stamped the name Impact on it because we believe that anytime God shows up, there's an impact. And we're believing that this impact that our region is going to see and experience is going to happen in multifaceted ways. One, we know that the greatest impact that happens in a person's individual life is when they are encountered and impacted with the presence of God, when lives are changed. At this event, when thousands of people gather to worship, to sing, the gospel is going to be preached with clarity, and people are going to have an opportunity to surrender their life to Jesus Christ. That's where the spiritual impact takes place. We believe that this is going to have an impact on families. This an event, a high-quality event of this caliber where families can come together, where mom and dad can be heroes for a day. We're believing that families are going to be impacted. The communities of Southern Illinois will be impacted whenever a crowd of people like this will be coming in on an area. We're believing that there's going to be economic impact. And guys, and here's what's really cool. We believe that whenever kingdom impact happens, it doesn't happen just for a day. We believe in lasting impact for a region. And here's what's really cool. I know some of you have heard it before, but we want to continue to cast this vision that this is not just a one-day event. We're believing that this event will be able to impact this region in such a way that there will be a residual impact felt for years to come. And one of the ways that we're going to do that is every dollar raised above the budget, right now that we're raising a budget of about $75,000, where local businesses are partnering with us. We're so thankful for the partnerships we've had with businesses so far. Next month, we're going to begin to open that up for individual donations. But here's what's exciting. Every dollar above the $75,000 budget to put this event on will be given right back into the community of Southern Illinois, into ministries that are sowing into this region, that ministries that are pouring into people's lives. Guys, we believe that impact takes place when we are intentional to sow into places that are making a difference for the gospel. So we want to encourage you to be a part of it in whatever way God leads you to be. Guys, I'm so excited that you're here. We believe that God is going to do something amazing in each of your lives this morning. Would you stand with us as we come back into a time of worship? Let me pray over us. We just thank you and are so thankful that you're here with us today. Lord Jesus, I thank you, Father, for what you're going to do today. Lord, your word says, in all things, through prayer and supplication and with thanksgiving, make your requests known to the Lord. Lord, I just declare that we are thankful for what you're going to do this morning, for the impact that people will experience with your presence this day. May you be glorified, lifted high, and exalted. King Jesus, you're alive, and we celebrate you this day. Amen, amen, amen.
Lord, we just thank you. We just thank you. Just come and have your way.
There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of Life had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake. And the veil was torn. What a sacrifice was made as the heavens roared. Oh, hail King Jesus. Oh, hail the Lord. Yeah.
place, let's just lift our hands together and begin to bless the Lord. Lord, you're good. Lord, you're good. Lord, we say that you are worthy. We say that you are worthy to receive all honor and all glory. Lord, so we bless you for this time. We bless you for this moment. Lord, we bless you that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that you are the one who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, we bless you. We bless you. We bless you. Just begin to bless the Lord. Begin to bless the Lord.
Oh, hail Queen Jesus. Oh, hail the Lord of heaven and earth. Oh, hail Queen Jesus. Oh, hail the Savior of the world. Oh, hail Queen Jesus.
Out of this place, Lord. But we want to encounter you this morning, Jesus. We want to encounter you. Oh, we want to encounter you, Lord. Just sing that again, all hail.
Took the nails for me.
morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon Him. You are worthy of the highest praise, Jesus. One final breath He gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The storm was rolled away. His perfect love could not.
Morning, don't we, church? We believe that this morning, don't we, church, that he is alive? Man, if we don't believe that, church, then why are we here? If we don't believe that, church, then we're just wasting some time this morning. If we don't believe that, church, then we're just doing something just kind of gives us some little goosebumps and it makes us feel good, makes us feel like we're doing something with our life. But let me tell you something, and you already know this, the tomb is empty this morning. And he is alive this morning. That I serve a not a dead king, but I serve a risen king. And he is the Lord over my life. He is the king of my life. He controls everything. I'm so grateful that I'm forgiven. I don't know about you, but I'm so grateful that I am forgiven. Thankful for the blood. I'm thankful that there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. Aren't you glad about that? I'm thankful for his grace and his mercy upon my life each and every day. Man, I'm not perfect, and I know you're not perfect, but I'm thankful that I serve a perfect Lord and a perfect King who sees me not as I think I am, but sees me as a son of God. He sees me as his child. He says, you know, I know Ronnie's not perfect, but you know what? He's my son. And it's by my and I see the blood that is on his life, covered by the blood of Jesus that has made him perfect. That has made him perfect. So Lord, we give you glory. God, we give you praise. It's not about making us feel good this morning that we got out of bed and put some nice clothes on and showed up on an Easter Sunday morning. But God, it's about giving you glory and about giving you praise because you are worthy of it this morning. You are worthy. There is no other one that is worthy of praise. Buddha, he's not worthy. Muhammad, he's not worthy. Joseph Smith, he's not worthy this morning. Nobody's gathering around to worship them this morning, but we are worshiping you, Lord, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords. You are worthy, and we acknowledge that this morning. And because you're Lord, we can bring our requests to you. We can bring our needs before you. And I know in a room like this, Lord, there are so many needs. There are so many situations. There is those that need healing this morning. I can't think of a better time for you to receive the healing that you've been praying for this very day, this very morning. If you would, just partner with me in a time of prayer for Kyle and Jordan Hicks, their son, is in the hospital, Klein Hicks, back in Evansville. He's 5 or 6 years old. And so they're asking for healing. They need peace. Some of the lab works came back and didn't give the right report. But you know what? The lab works, they don't have the last say, right? Our Heavenly Father does. And if you're here this morning, you say, you know, Ronnie, I need prayer in my own life. I need healing in my own life. I know someone in my life that needs healing, needs prayer. Would you slip up your hand really quick and just acknowledge it to us this morning? Thank you. I'm going to lump you into that prayer. Is that okay? Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for each and every person that is here. We're going to pray for these. And God, we lift up flying before you. And God, we pray, Lord, that you begin to touch that body in Jesus' name. We pray, God, that in that hospital room, that room would be filled with your angels. God, that your healing hand would reach down and would begin to touch that little body this morning, God. That there will no longer be any more complications in Jesus' name. We don't pray a prayer of weakness, but we pray a prayer of boldness and of conviction of knowing that there's nothing impossible for you. We serve the impossible God. So we ask God that your will be done, Lord, and there will be a complete healing right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, the name that is above what? All names, right? The name that is all that brings healing and salvation. We pray in Jesus' name, Would you touch them right now? And all those that lifted their hands up this morning, I pray for a complete healing over each and every situation, over each and every life this morning. God, you know the detail. You know the circumstances that they're facing. God, you've heard their cries. You've heard their prayers day in and day out. And so, God, I pray that this morning right now, that they would receive their healing right now. They would receive their answer to the prayer that they've been seeking for so long. Lord God, we lift your name on high. And God, we give you praise and glory. For you are a good God. You are a merciful God. God, and we thank you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Ushers are coming forward. If you would stay in this attitude of worship, we're going to receive the Lord's offering. We believe here at Little Chapel Church that giving unto the Lord is an act of worship. It's not just something we do because we want to support a church or anything like that, but we do it because we realize that He is the Lord of our life. There's so many things in our life that has a grip on us that many times begin to control us. But when you come to know the Lord as your personal Lord and Savior, first thing you declare is that He is the Lord of my life. Not just the things that I say, not just how I think, not just my actions, not just what I do, but also in my finances too. And sometimes that can be the hardest thing, right? Because we want to hold on to it. But we realize that if He's the Lord of my life, that even my finances, I need to let go of those and then give unto the Lord. So it's an act of worship. We begin to worship the Lord even in our tithes and offerings this morning. And as God begins to bless you mightily in a time of worship, as you begin to worship Him in singing, we believe that as you begin to worship Him even in your giving, God will begin to bless you in a mighty way. How many of you want God to bless you in a mighty way in your finances? I don't know, right? We believe that this morning. So we're going to continue with worship. I'm going to pray for the offering. If you just continue to remain standing, and we're going to continue with worship as we receive the Lord's offering this morning. Heavenly Father God, we declare each and every Sunday morning, not just this Sunday morning, that you're the King of all kings, and God, that you are the King of our life. So we acknowledge, Lord, that even in this area of our finances, Lord, that it's an act of worship. God, I pray that you see our act of worship as good, God, without holding back, without in reservation, Lord, but that we will begin to give unto you all that we have. And God, we begin to see the store gates begin to open up, showers of blessings begin to fall on your children, Lord, I pray. So I pray for each and every need, especially financially. God, those that need jobs, God, provide jobs for them. Those that need doors open, God, provide doors open would otherwise be closed for anyone else. But because of you, they are your children, those doors are being opened right now in Jesus' name. God, I pray that you'd be honored through our worship this morning. As we begin, God, let it go forth, and let it go forth to build your kingdom, so you build your kingdom that will last forever. We pray in Jesus' name. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
Yes, church, he's alive. He is alive. And that's a reason to shout. If you're thankful he's alive, say yes. If you believe he's alive, say yes. If you believe he's going to move today, say yes. Before you're seated, high five your neighbor and say, get ready. All right, you can be seated in the name of the Lord this morning. Good stuff is coming. God is good. God is good. And all the time, God is good. Man, take me back to Sunday school and church camp. Come on, somebody. All right. Oh, man. All right. Guys, I'm excited about what God is going to do this day, this week, and in our lives. And I'm thankful. Here's what I'm thankful for. The fact that, and really this is like kind of the hope that I have this morning, that we begin to view what we're celebrating today more than just a day of celebration. But this reality of resurrection power becomes the place that we live, operate, and have our being from. That we know that what Christ has made available to us through his death, burial, and resurrection is not just to celebrate, but it's to live in. Come on, somebody. That's what we're going for. And here's the thing. If you're new here, I like it when you help me preach. So look at your neighbor and say, help him preach. I need your help today, God. I need your help. Lord, I thank you for this message. Lord, I pray that you would go forth with power and conviction. Holy Spirit, that you would move and have your way. Guard my lips that not a single word that I speak would be of my own, but it would be birthed from your heart to your people, calling us and raising us in to the life that you destined for us to walk in. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to get right into the word because it's powerful. Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10. You can follow along on the screens or open your Bible, turn on your Bible, however that looks for you. But we're going to get after it this morning. Matthew 28, again, verses 1 through 10. Now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred. And an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing was white as snow. The guards shook for fear because of him, and he became like a dead man. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. But he is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come see the place where he was lying. Go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." And they left the tomb quickly with fear and joy and ran to report it to the disciples. And behold, Jesus met them. Aren't you thankful that Jesus has met you? Come on, somebody. I'm thankful that Jesus has met me. Behold, Jesus met them and greeted them. And they came quickly and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go, take word to my brethren and leave for Galilee, and there they will see me." Oh, man. He is risen, guys. This day, what we celebrate this day is the reason we are here. Right? I mean, without the resurrection, this is just a gathering place. Without the resurrection, this is just a time of sing-along and high fives. Without the resurrection, what we do really doesn't mean anything. It's because of the fact that Jesus is alive that we have been brought into new life, and that's why we come together to celebrate today. We're celebrating life. Not just the life of Jesus. That's what brings us together. But we're celebrating the life that Jesus paid to bring us all into. That's a reason to be excited, and that is a reason to celebrate. It's all about the resurrection. What we have in Christ is unavailable minus his resurrection. Without the resurrection of Christ, none of this matters. But it's because he's alive that he has repositioned us. He's given us a new seat. The word says that we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. And understand how the word states that phrase. It does not say that one day when you die, you will be seated with Christ. No, there was a seating change. There was a repositioning in your assignment. The moment you said yes to Jesus, you were spiritually set with Christ in high places. That means he's given you a perspective change. It means that because you've received new life, you begin to look at things different. You see people differently. Different because you've been given a new seating assignment. It's all because Jesus is alive. That's why we celebrate. We celebrate this day once a year, but the reality is his victory over death, hell, sin, and the grave is something that he has paid the price that we would walk in daily. It's not just a one-day thing. This is the new life of the believing believer. A new life that, as Paul says, has become more than a conqueror. We just don't win. We keep on winning and winning and winning and winning because Jesus paid the price for us. You guys understand? His victory has become our victory. It is already done. It's finished. That's what Jesus said. I'm not saying nothing that Jesus didn't already say. Come on, somebody. We're going to have fun this morning. This is the reality of who we are in Christ. Brand new. We celebrate this day. We honor this day. We acknowledge this day. But guys, it's more than a day. This resurrection life is just that. It is life. Life to the full. This is what Jesus paid for us to walk in. The thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but Jesus said, I have come that you would have life and have it to the full. The fullness of life is the Zoe life in the Greek that literally translates to the absolute full measure thereof. Jesus came, died, paid a price, and was risen back to life that we would come into the absolute fullness of life. That's what he has for us. That's resurrected life. And it's not just what Jesus walks in, it's what he paid for all of us to walk in. That's something to be excited about. So it's my goal this morning to just continually build and encourage us in this place of hope and believing that the Holy Spirit would stir in you this revelation that you are victorious. Not one day you will be, but you are seated with Christ. You are victorious in your life. That it's my goal that when we begin to catch the revelation that Christ has made us more than a conqueror, that through Jesus, your promise is life and life to the full, and that all Jesus paid to bring you into is for each and every day that you live. That's the goal this morning. So high five your neighbor and tell them my title. Tell them it's hammer time. Come on, somebody. It's hammer time. Come on. Do the dance, somebody said. And when I was in second grade, I would dance all over that. You don't even know. You don't even know in second grade how I went to Halloween as MC Hammer with gold flash pants, big chains. Man, I look so good. Second grade, MC, it's hammer time. Oh, man. All right. I'm excited about what we're going to talk about today, but you know, we will have fun. I love to have fun when I preach. I hope that you're encouraged as the word goes forth. But as I'm speaking to you this morning, much of what will be disclosed this morning is heavy. It's a heavy word, but it's transforming. And that's really what the Word of God is. The Word of God is not just sugar and cream that you add to your life. No, the Word of God is meant to go forth to convict our heart and pull us into something more. And sometimes the Word of God doesn't necessarily come across in a really comfortable manner. Anyone ever notice that? Like God's Word is meant to mold us and shape us and bring us into something more. How many of you know that in order to get molded and shaped into something as you were created to be, at some times it might cause a little discomfort? Now, I'm not hoping that you're uncomfortable as the Word goes forth today, but what I'm saying is that the reality of His Word is that it's not about making you comfortable. It's about revealing truth so that you can come to a place of decision where you realize that He is Lord and He's worthy of everything you have to offer. So it's my prayer today that I just continually try to get out of the way, hide behind the cross and under the blood, and let the Holy Spirit do whatever He wants to do. I hope that's the position of your heart this morning. When you're positioned in such a way that you're just like, Holy Spirit, here I am. Do with me what you want so you can do through me whatever you will. Man, that's what the Word of God is. That's what His Word does. It's transforming in nature. So let's go to the Garden of Gethsemane. In Luke chapter 22, verses 39 through 44. This is it's really a pivotal point in the life of Jesus. This is this time in this week, the Passion Week that we just came out of, or that we're celebrating, that we celebrated last week, even when we began last Sunday with the message on the triumphal procession into Jerusalem. We saw the people waving the palm branches, shouting, Hosanna. Hosanna is He, right? They're shouting to a king that they were hoping in that moment would come in and establish a kingdom to overthrow the Roman government. So they're worshiping a king. They're worshiping a king in hopes that he would reign. In hopes that he would reign in that moment. And here's the thing, guys, that I want us to know, that Jesus is our King. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He is reigning supreme on high. That is still what he is doing. But in order for him to reign on high, he has to reign in our life. He needs to reign supreme in our own lives personally. He is our King, and he deserves to be followed. He deserves to have people who are willing to lay their life down. But we began last Sunday with the triumphal entry of Christ. And now he's gone through the week. And now we find him in Luke chapter 22 at the Garden of Gethsemane. So what we're seeing here is this Passion Week is culminating to a place of purpose. This Passion Week is culminating to a place of purpose. And what we see is that Jesus passionately pursued the purpose that God ordained for him to walk in. This purpose that God ordained for Jesus to walk in was so deep but yet so profound. The purpose that Jesus walked in was revealing the heart of God to be a good father, loving the unlovable, healing the sick, raising the dead, casting out demons, bringing freedom to the oppressed. And Jesus is now at this point where he is ready to walk in to the full measure of God's will. And it's interesting to note that Gethsemane, the word itself literally translates to the place of pressing. The place of pressing. The Garden of Gethsemane was also referred to and known to be the Mount of Olives. And if you know anything about Jewish culture, man, the olives are used in their everyday life, and there's olive presses that squeeze the juice out of the olives. And so the olives, in order for there to be juice, they have to be squeezed. And the juice that comes from the olive, when it is squeezed, it is pure, and it is just it's used for so many things. So Jesus himself, he's going to the Garden of Gethsemane, the place of pressing. There are times, and this is what I really want us to hear, even in this first point here. There are times that the only way to get to God's promise and his purpose is to go through the pressing place. You see, there are things that God will call you into that are amazing. That he gives you this promise and your heart comes alive and it begins to beat and you're saying, yes, I will give my life to see that come to pass. Whatever it takes. And then as you're following him, sometimes he'll take you to a place of pressing. So that when the pressing takes place, the only thing that's left is that which is pure. That's how we're called to walk and follow him. It's uncomfortable, I get it, but I want to tell you guys, and someone just needs to know, that in order for the promise and the purpose of God to be fulfilled in your life, sometimes it will mean that you have to go to the place of pressing. It's not easy, but it's worth it. Throughout Scripture, we see people who went to their own place of pressing to come into their purpose, to come into their destiny, to step in to God's promise. We see people who did not live a comfortable, cushy life all the time as they were following God's plan for their life. Remember Moses. We talked a little bit about Moses last week. Moses had a position in the palace. Moses was set up for a life of an easy life. Moses was set up to be a ruler within the palace of Pharaoh. He was set up. He had it all. He had everything that the world would say that he needed. But yet to get to what God was calling him to do, to be the leader that God ordained for him to be, he had to walk away from all of that to a time in the desert for 40 years where the pressing would take place. And it was only, I would suggest to you, through the time of pressing that Moses was enabled to come back and empowered to be the leader that God destined for him to be. King David, another one, receiving this promise, this anointing at a very young age. Most people would agree between 9 and 12 years old when the prophet Samuel anointed David to be king of the nation of Israel. And then David goes back to life, and you know the story of David, how as he's growing up, he faces the giant, and he slays the giant Goliath, and he comes in, and he's serving in the house of Saul, but then Saul becomes jealous of the anointing that's on this one. Saul the king tries to kill David several times, and David now goes fleeing for his life. He has this incredible promise that he's going to be king one day, but now for years, David is hiding in the caves to avoid the armies. Saul, King Saul, dispatched all the armies of Israel to find one man to kill him. Now David is hiding for his life in the caves, and we read through the Psalms and we see that David is, he cries out to God. He even asks the question, God, why have you forsaken me in this place? My enemies rise up against me. But then you see the one whose heart is just devoted to him, that he just in the same breath that he's complaining, he says, yet I trust you. You see, guys, it's in this place where it seems like you're being pressed on every side that you are forced back to this place that, yes, I will either let the pressing destroy me or I will let the pressing perfect me. Come on, somebody. That was good preaching right there. I will either let this time of pressing destroy me and move me out of my comfort, because what we do in the times of pressing is we try to run away from it, don't we? That's what's natural, because that's what's easy. I don't want to be uncomfortable. I don't want things to be hard. I want things to be easy. I don't want to take big risks. I don't want to possibly fail. So I want to be comfortable, happy in all of my life. And so the natural thing for us to do is when the pressing begins is to try to get out of the press to make things easy so we can just be comfortable. You will either try to escape the pressing, which will actually destroy your purpose, or you can embrace it and allow God to perfect you in it. And then come out on the other side, ready to handle what God is releasing. That's what David did. As David was hiding in the caves, running for his life, a band of misfits, the word says, a band of misfits found David and came knocking on the cave door. And David began to lead 500 misfits into battles. David began to have victories with 500 guys that were crazy just like him. And that band of rebels prepared him to lead a nation. You see, what God was doing in the time of pressing was actually positioning and training him to step into and lead a nation. Jesus is in this place of pressing. He's in this time where it's hurting, it's hard. I'm not saying, guys, that God causes the pressing, but what I am saying without a doubt is that God can use the pressing. God will use whatever you go through. God will use whatever comes to press you or crush you. He will use it and cause it to work out for your good. God will use whatever tries to crush you, because I just think God likes punching the devil in the teeth. Come on, somebody. And what a greater testament to the hand of God on your life is to face the pressing that comes against you and come out better for it and look and say, devil, you tried to press me, but God perfected me. Come on, somebody. Hey, I get excited. So there's two ways. There's two ways to look at the pressing that comes against your life. You can look at the pressing and that would cause you to run from it, or you can embrace the pressing and say, God's going to make me better because of it. Touch somebody and say, there's purpose in the pressing. Touch somebody and say, there's purpose in the pressing. There's purpose in the pressing. And the key to accessing God's promise through the times of pressing is being aligned with his will. Did you hear that? It's in the times of pressing, the key to accessing what God is doing in the times of pressing is being aligned to his will. And this is what Jesus did. Jesus is in this garden and he says, he's praying to God, his Father, because Jesus knows what is coming in this time. He spoke it to his disciples. He knows what he is about to endure. He knows what is coming. He knows the crushing that is coming to him. And Jesus prays this very honest prayer. How many of you know that you can be really honest with God? Because he already knows your heart anyway. He knows what you're going through. He knows your thoughts. There's something powerful about just being honest. And Jesus, the Son of God, says these words. He says, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. He's saying, God, I don't want to go through this. I don't want to endure what I know is coming. If there's any other way to accomplish your will, let it be. Let's do it that way. Anyone ever tried to talk God into doing it your way? If there's any other way, let this cup pass. But then you know what he says. He says, yet not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. I know that everyone in here can attest to this if you followed Jesus for very long, that sometimes God's will doesn't look like your will. But God has a plan. God has a plan that if you choose to align your will, and guys, and it's a choice. It's a choice to position yourself aligned with God's will. That's the key to accessing the promise that God has. It's not trying to do your own thing, but aligning yourself, your desires, your wants, according to his will. God, if there's any way that this cup can pass from me, let it be, but not my will, but yours be done. Yours be done in my life, no matter what that means. Your will be done in my life, no matter what may happen. Your will be done. You see, Jesus in the garden is making this choice, affirming once again, your will be done. Not my will, but yours be done. Purpose can only be realized when we submit our lives to his will. Promise and purpose can only come to pass through the submission of your life to God's will. This is what Jesus modeled so well. Not my will, but yours be done. So what is God's will? And this is kind of where we want to build from. Jesus is saying, not my will, but yours be done. So it's important that we know what the will of God in this time really is. The will of God is very real and it's very plain and it's evident because of what he did to see it come to pass. In 2 Peter 3, verse 9, part B, it says, it's his will that not any would perish, but that all would come to repentance. It's the will of God that nobody would perish outside of a relationship with him, but that everyone would come to a place of repentance. That is the will of God. And this, because of his will, because that is his will, this is why Jesus came. Jesus came to make a way for God's will to be accomplished. That's the purpose of Christ. That's the purpose of the crucifixion, so that the will of God, that none would perish, but all would come to repentance, so that the will of God would come to fruition. He, Jesus, was God's plan of redemption for all of creation. Jesus was God's plan of redemption. Jesus is God's plan of redemption for all creation. You see, it's only through Jesus that we can be saved. That's it. And so Jesus comes and he's saying, not my will, but yours be done. You see, Jesus came to save us because whether you are sitting out here and you realize this or not, this is true. We need a Savior. We need a Savior. Every single one of us in this place, we are in need of a Savior. Jesus became exactly what we needed by fulfilling the will of God. Because the truth is, how you say, well, why do I need a Savior, TW? Well, here's why you need a Savior. Because we know it's true. The Word says it, that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. Every one of us. Every one of us have missed it. Look at your neighbor and say, you've missed it. We've all missed it. Look back and say, don't talk to me like that. Say, it's the Holy Spirit's job to convict me, not you. Anyway, it's okay. We've all missed it, guys. We've missed it and we've fallen short. The reality is every single one of us in this room, no matter how perfect you are, ladies, we've all sinned. We've all sinned. See, I only mention the ladies because us guys know we've screwed up, man. We've all missed it. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Some might be asking, well, what is sin? Sin, very simply, is anything less than perfect. If you have been less than perfect in any way, you've sinned. Congratulations, you are in good company. Because it's all of us. Every one of us have been less than perfect. If you've ever told a lie, you're less than perfect. If you've ever taken something that didn't belong to you, that means that you're a thief, not a stealer. That's a football team, okay? Yeah, there it is. Okay. They're not as good as the Chiefs, but that's all right. Anyway, come on, somebody. If you've ever taken something that doesn't belong to you, that means you're a thief. Jesus said that if you've ever looked at someone with lust in your eyes, you've already committed adultery. Guys, we are all without excuse. We have all missed it. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the measure of perfection that's required to be reunited with our Father in heaven. We need a Savior. Do we understand that? Just trying to make this really simple. We need a Savior. And that's why Jesus came. Jesus came for this purpose. Jesus came for this purpose to become the sacrifice that would pay the penalty required for your sins to be forgiven. Jesus came to become the sacrifice that would pay the penalty for your sins to be forgiven. The Word says that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. So Jesus came to offer himself according to the will of God as a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the world to be forgiven. He received the punishment that we deserved. And so now Jesus, he said this prayer, not my will, but yours be done. And we read in the Gospels that Jesus, through tears and through his sweat that became as drops of blood, he looks up while bringing the alignment of his heart to God's will. He looks up and he sees a crowd approaching. He sees the torches burning. He hears the chains clanging. And as the crowd gets closer, he sees one who had followed him for the last 3.5 years leading these people. He comes and he embraces Jesus and he says, Rabbi, and gives him a kiss. And Jesus asked Judas in this moment, is it with this kiss that you betray me? And in that moment, the guards came and they seized Jesus, putting the chains on his hands. They grabbed him and physically moved him to the place of the high priest where they began to judge Jesus for crimes that he never committed. The disciples who were with him, they scattered. They ran away. Peter tried to follow him at a distance. But now Jesus is alone before the high priest, and they're bringing accusations against him. People are lying about him. He is betrayed. He's forgotten. He's all alone. We're going to talk about more things that Jesus endured, but I want you to know on the front side that we have a high priest that can sympathize with anything you've gone through. That's what Hebrews says. The book of Hebrews says that Jesus is one who can sympathize and empathize with anything you've endured. Has anybody ever been lied about? I would say everyone in here could say at some point someone's told lies about me. Jesus can relate to that. Has anyone been betrayed? I would say so. Jesus can relate to that. Has anybody ever been judged and found guilty for something you didn't do? Maybe it was by your mom when your brother lied about you. We can all relate to things in some way, form, or fashion that Jesus endured and went through. So the high priest, they find him guilty and they take him to Pilate. And Pilate standing before, Jesus standing before Pilate. Pilate makes these statements. He questions him and he says, I find nothing wrong with this man. The reason why Pilate could not find anything wrong with Jesus is because Jesus did nothing wrong. He was perfect. The only thing that Jesus did was love the unlovable, heal the sick, raise the dead, bring freedom to those who are oppressed. The only thing that Jesus did was reveal the heart of God towards creation. And so Pilate says, I can't find anything wrong with this man. And he asked the question, what would you have me do with him? And this crowd raises their voices in unison and they begin to cry out, crucify him! Crucify him! The crucifixion was the worst death anyone could endure. And this crowd who was praising him just days before is now speaking in a unified voice, kill him, murder him, put him to death. And this is the fate that Jesus would go on to endure. And as they take Jesus from there, they bring him to this place where they tie his hands to this post. And one of the Roman centurions, usually the biggest and the strongest because of the endurance required to carry out this punishment, picked up what is called the cat of nine tails, a whip with nine leather strands with bone and metal at the ends. And he begins to rip this whip across the back of Jesus. It's not an easy thing to hear. It's not an easy thing to imagine. But we need to be aware of the price that was paid for the freedom that we now can walk in, church. So Jesus he's enduring this torture as he's being whipped to the point of death. Flesh is being ripped away from his body for something that he didn't do, but he endured the penalty anyway. And when they were done beating him to this point, they spit on him. They made fun of him. They mocked him. And then after all of this, they looked at Jesus and they said, now, pick up your cross and carry it up that hill. And Jesus, the Son of God, perfect in all of his ways, picked up this cross, and he began the journey to the hill that would ultimately claim his life. And when he got to the top of this hill, when the cross fell, I just pictured Jesus with the remaining strength of his body grabbing the cross instead of trying to flee from it, because as I said, it's so easy to try to run away from things that are uncomfortable, but instead, because Jesus, his heart was aligned with the will of God, with the rest of the strength of his body, he grabbed the cross and pulled himself onto it and spread his arms out one more time with one more act of sacrificial love, just saying, this is why I came. This is why I came. To open my arms that all would come in. Do you see that? Even in the position that Jesus took, it was a position of welcoming. Even this morning, Jesus is welcoming people into his family. This is what Jesus does. So Jesus is taken to the cross. Jesus is taken to the cross, and the soldiers again have these nails that they placed in the hands and the feet of Jesus. And each nail, as it went through his hand, it was a reminder of the sacrifice that was taking place. Three nails that went in to the body of Jesus through his hands and through his feet. And Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, is now nailed to a cross. The reality is, as I said, that Jesus in this moment, he's receiving a punishment that's not his. He's enduring pain that no man should be able to walk through. No man should be able to endure. Yet Jesus is doing it willingly. And then to culminate this, what Jesus is experiencing in Luke chapter 24, Jesus with a breath proclaims these words, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Can you imagine This one who has endured agony and suffering beyond anything any of us could comprehend. Now, at the hands of the ones who are killing him, he cries, Father, forgive him. But let me tell you something, church. He wasn't just talking to the ones begging for his death. He was not just talking to the one who scourged him and beat him. He wasn't just talking to the ones who spit on him. He wasn't talking to the ones who nailed him to the cross. He was talking to the ones whose sin put him there. Guys, I want you to let you know something this morning. He was talking to you and to me. The words of Jesus, listen to this, guys. This is so true and so powerful. The words of Jesus 2,000 years ago echoed through eternity, a prophetic utterance, and he's still proclaiming over you today, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. What Jesus declared, he is still declaring. He was speaking it over you and myself because it was our sin that put him there. Anything you've done wrong, it put him there. So if we just have this piece of paper right here representing your life, could you write the things you've done wrong on this paper? Would this be big enough to contain all the times that you've missed it? I need a marker. Anyone have a marker? Anybody have one? You have one? Come up here. Hurry, bring it to me. Evan, it's almost like you knew this was coming. Come on, hurry, man, hurry. Come on. Thanks, buddy. Could this contain the things that you've done wrong? Just think with me, even the times that you lied, could you write that down? The times that you had thoughts that weren't your own, can you write that down? Well, how about the times that you took things that weren't yours? You begin to write that down. How about the time that you looked at things that you knew were breaking the heart of God? How about the times that you treated people with hate and contempt? Guys, the list is so long. The times that you allowed your desire for consumption of alcohol and drugs and all of these things, and I'm not saying anything to condemn you. I'm just saying, guys, we've missed it. And our list is pretty long. We could write these things down. The times we've hurt people. The times when I didn't care about myself enough, so I hurt myself. The times, all the times, all the times. We've missed it, guys. We have a list. We have a list that if we're honest, man, this can't contain it. This morning, I want to suggest to you that when Jesus went to the cross, he brought more than just himself. And this is not just a suggestion, this is reality. The word says that he bore our sins in his body. When Jesus went to the cross, your sin went with him. It was your sin that put him there. It was my sin that put him there. Guys, this is real stuff, man. I think about what he's done, the things that I've done, the fact that it was my pain, it was my sin, it was my decisions that put Jesus on the cross. You see, guys, Jesus, he didn't go by himself. Jesus took your sin upon himself. Your sin, my sin, the sin of the world, and nailed him to the cross. This is what Jesus took with him. It wasn't the Roman soldiers that put him on the cross. It was you and I, with our decisions, with our choices, with the sin of our life, that nailed a Savior, perfect in all of his ways, to a tree, that put Jesus on a place where he didn't deserve to be. It was you and me, and it's good, and it's about time that we understand that it was us. All have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. And Jesus, with his final breath, with the final breath that is in his lungs in this moment, he declares, "It is finished." The word says, knowing that the scriptures were fulfilled, he said, "It's finished." When Jesus said, "It is finished," he was speaking to more than just the will of God for his life in this moment. When he said, "It is finished," Jesus again was making a prophetic utterance to every single person who would ever hear this message. He was saying that sin's power over your life is finished. Anything that sin could produce in your life is finished. That because of what Jesus did, it was enough. It's not up to you to try to figure it out. It's not up to you to do anything different. The price has already been paid in church. It is finished. The price was paid so that you could be made whole. He himself bore our sins in his body that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. 1 Peter 2:24. That word healed means to be made whole, free from sin. To be made whole, free from sin. It's finished. Anything that sin could produce in your life is finished. Anything that sin could do in your life is finished because of what Jesus did. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Sin would cause death, but Jesus, because it is finished, said, "You have life." He was crushed for our transgression, bruised for our iniquities. The punishment of our sin was upon him, and by his stripes you were healed. You see, there's this exchange. "It is finished" became a door of transition. The cross became a transition from death to life. The cross became a door of transition from shame to hope. The cross became a place of transition for every single one of us, because the story doesn't end with Jesus on a cross. The story doesn't end with a dead, bloody Jesus hanging on the cross. No, 3 days later, come on somebody, 3 days later, 3 days later, 3 days later, the stone was rolled away, and Jesus Christ, the Son of God, had the very breath of God fill his lungs again, and he came alive, signifying the new life you have with Christ Jesus. Because he's alive, you can live. Because he's alive, he's brought you into life. We live because he lives. He's alive. He's alive. And because he's alive, you can have the life he purchased for you. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. He made a way that you would be forgiven, so that anything that would separate you from a loving Father would be done away with. Everyone in here, in just a moment, you're going to have the opportunity to give your lives wholly and completely to Christ. I want to ask right now that no one would move, no one would try to leave. This is a moment where lives will be changed and eternities will be altered. Out of respect for what God is doing, the cross was a place of transition from death to life. The only thing that stayed on the cross was the sin that put him there. The only thing that stayed on the cross was the sin that put him there. When you come to Jesus, Paul says, "I've been crucified with Christ. The life I live, I now live in Christ Jesus." When you come to Jesus, you come to a place of death so that you can be brought into a place of life. And here is what your life looks like. Here is what your life looks like on the other side. The cross is a transition. Now you came to Him in your sin, in your shame, facing death, what sin would produce, and now He's given you life. And on the other side, you stand forgiven. On the other side, you stand forgiven. You stand with hope. You stand with freedom. This is the transition of the cross. This is what it means to be forgiven, to be saved. You are forgiven. But forgiveness comes through right relationship with Jesus. You can't earn it on your own. Life comes as the result of death. Dying to yourself so that you would be made alive in Christ. Right now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, Holy Spirit, would you speak to the hearts of your children? Everyone in this room, while no one is moving, no one is stirring, speak to those who right now are far from you. To these who may know the story, who may know about all of these things but have never come to a place of surrender. Holy One, would you speak to their hearts? And you know in this moment that God is speaking to you because you literally feel it. That's me. Would you speak to those in this place that at one time we're walking with Jesus, one time we're living where God had called you to live, but because you began to get pressed, because things happened, you have now fallen away, and you know that today is the day that you come back to what you were created for. So whether you're here and you say, I need to give my life to Jesus for the first time, or maybe you're here and you're saying, I need to rededicate my life to Christ. No more games. I'm all in. This is a call for you. With every head bowed and every eye closed, we're all going to pray together. I say this every time we do this. This prayer does not save you. God sees your heart. And when God sees a heart that's repentant and turning to Him, that's the place where He sends His Spirit to dwell. And at that time, He calls you His own. At that time, He brings salvation. At that time, your life is changed and your eternity is altered. So please, with every head bowed and every eye closed, would every single person in this room say these words with me? Say, Jesus, thank you for loving me. Loving me enough to go through everything you did, to die for me. I know it was my sin that put you on the cross. And I ask your forgiveness of anything I've done that has offended your heart. I repent of those things. I repent of a life that has not brought you glory. And today I choose to give you everything. Today is my day of surrender. Today is my day of death. And today, through you, is my day of life. I'm all yours, Jesus. In your name I pray. I commit my life.